morning, Pastor Romain. And so just a wide variety of opportunities to gather during the week for the study of God's Word. Let's turn now to Genesis chapter 30 as we continue our journey through the Bible. Again, chapter 30 actually begins in chapter 29 as we begin to get the birth of the sons of Jacob, who will comprise the fathers of the 12 tribes of Israel. And so this is the beginning of the 12 tribes. And Leah, who is loved less by Jacob, she's the one that was sort of given to him as a cast-off by the shrewdness of his uncle Laban. And Jacob loved Rachel. He served for Rachel. And thus he loved Rachel more than Leah. It made a very difficult situation because it put the two sisters then more or less in competition with each other. Leah realizing, I mean, it was very obvious that Jacob loved Rachel more, and she felt less loved. And thus God opened her womb, and she was the first to conceive and to bear a son to Jacob. And that, of course, begins in chapter 29, verse 32. Leah conceived and bore a son. She called his name Reuben, for she said, "Surely the Lord has looked upon my affliction, and now will my husband love me." That is sad. It's a very pathetic picture of a gal who realizes that her husband doesn't have a great love for her, and hoping now that because she bears him a son, that surely he will love her. Reuben means see a son. And then she conceived again and bore a second son. And she says, "Because the Lord has heard that I was hated, he has therefore given me this son also." She called his name Simeon, which means hearing. The Lord has heard. And thus she calls his name Simeon. And we see in the naming of the sons a common practice, and that is how they named their sons many times after hopes, aspirations, or after circumstances of their birth. Jacob himself was a twin. His older brother, or the brother that came first out of the womb, was Esau. Esau was covered with hair, and so they named him Hairy. When Jacob was born, right after Esau, Jacob reached over and grabbed Esau's heel, and say they called him Heel Catcher. And thus their names were many times after circumstances of their birth or hopes and aspirations. Here is the hope. God has seen me. He has seen my distress. He is Reuben. God has heard my cry. She names the son Simeon. And so she conceived again, and she bore the third son, and she named him Levi, which means joined. Now will my husband be joined to me, because I have given to him three sons. She conceived again and bore a son, and she said, "Now will I praise the Lord," and she called his name Judah, which means the praise of the Lord, praise. And so she bore these four sons and then left off bearing. So we come into chapter 30, and Rachel is watching her sister bear all these sons, and it happens that she is barren. Now, in that culture, it was more or less a cultural curse not to be able to bear children. It was a recognized and acceptable grounds for divorce if your wife could not bear a son for you to carry on the family name. And Rachel had not been able to bear children, and it was getting to her. She was being vexed seeing her sister have all of these sons, blessed with all of these sons, and thus Rachel was upset, and she came to Jacob, and she was envious of her sister. She said to Jacob, "Give me children or else I'll die." I mean, she's desperate. And Jacob was angry with Rachel. And he said, "Am I in God's stead who has withheld you from the fruit of the womb? I'm not God. What can I do?" And she said, "Behold my maid Bilhah. Go in unto her, and she shall bear upon my knees, that I may also have children by her." Now, this is surrogate motherhood. It is not something that is new. It goes way back. In fact, this isn't the first time in the Bible. You remember when Sarah was unable to bear children for Abraham, that finally she said, "Take my handmaid Hagar and bear us a child through her." It was a mistake. It created problems. It continues to create problems to the present day, because the Arabs are the descendants of Ishmael, who was born to Abraham through Hagar, the handmaid. Polygamy is not something that is acceptable even in the Bible. God allowed it, but because he allows it, it does not mean that he approves of it. Jesus certainly taught a monogamous relationship. "For this cause shall a man leave his mother and father and shall cleave to his wife, and they two shall become one flesh." And thus, the Lord definitely teaches monogamy in marriage. Polygamy would create many problems. I remember in taking a class in sociology that the professor of the class, who knew that I was a minister, I was doing some post-grad type of work, and he was always baiting me into debate because it made the class interesting for the other students. And we were always getting into it. And I obliged him. I enjoyed it. But he was talking in sociology about polygamy. And he said, "Can anybody see any advantage to polygamy?" And of course, all of the gals in the class couldn't see any advantage to it at all. And he had the class sort of, "No, it's a horrible thing." Well, to play the devil's advocate, I raised my hand. And he said, "Yes, Mr. Smith." I said, "Well, I can see advantages to polygamy. You could have one wife who was a great gourmet cook. She could stay in the kitchen, do all the cooking. You could have two or three wives that were highly skilled in secretarial work. You could send them out to work to, help you to live a very comfortable life. You could have a wife who was very beautiful, and you could just enjoy the company of her, but, the others are sort of taking care of you." And, of course, he was shocked that I would even... I said, "Wait a minute, it doesn't say I approve of this. You just asked, can anybody see any advantages? And I can see that would be an advantage, but there would be many disadvantages that would outweigh the advantages. I mean, you'd have all kinds of fights going on and jealousies and everything else. So the disadvantages surely outweigh the advantages." But it was just one of those. things. Now, we see here the disadvantages. We see the envy of Rachel for her sister Leah. We see Leah hoping and wanting to be loved by her husband, hurt because he obviously loves Rachel more. And now we see them getting involved with their mistresses as they give them to Jacob in order to bear children that would be related in a sense to them, surrogate motherhood. She said, "Behold, my maid Bilhah, go in unto her, and she shall bear upon my knees, that I may also have children by her." And she gave him Bilhah, her handmaid, to wife, and Jacob went unto her. And Bilhah conceived and bare Jacob a son. And Rachel said, "God has judged me, and has also heard my voice, and has given me a son." Therefore she called his name Dan, which means judge. And Bilhah, Rachel's maid, conceived again, bare Jacob a second son. And Rachel said, "With great wrestlings have I wrestled with my sister, and I have prevailed." And she called his name Naphtali, which means wrestling. And when Leah saw that she had quit bearing, she took Zilpah, her maid. I mean, here's this competition going. And she gave her Jacob to wife. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a son. And Leah said, "A troop cometh." And she called his name Gad. I mean, this is the beginning of a real race. And Gad means troop. And Zilpah, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a second son. And Leah said, "Happy am I, for the daughters will call me blessed." And she called his name Asher, which means happy. Happy am I. I've had six sons. And so Reuben, who was now about 5 or 6 years old, the oldest son, went in the days of the wheat harvest and found mandrakes in the field. And he brought them to his mother Leah. And then Rachel said to Leah, "Give me, I pray thee, of your son's mandrakes." Now, mandrakes are a fruit that grow around the area of Lebanon to the present day. It is sort of a distasteful fruit, but there is a strong belief, even to the present day, that eating of this fruit will help in fertility. And so when Reuben brings these mandrakes home to his mother, Rachel desires these mandrakes because of the belief that it would aid in fertility. And so she asked for Leah, "I pray thee, give me thy son's mandrakes." And she said unto her, "Is it a small matter that you have taken my husband? And would you take away my son's mandrakes also?" And Rachel said, "Therefore, he can lie with you tonight if you will give me your son's mandrakes." So as Jacob came out of the field in the evening, Leah went out to meet him and said, "You must come in unto me, for surely I have hired thee with my son's mandrakes." And so he lay with her that night, and God hearkened unto Leah, and she conceived and bare Jacob the fifth son. And Leah said, "God has given me my hire, because I have given my maiden to my husband." And she called his name Issachar, which means hired. And Leah conceived again and bare Jacob the sixth son. And Leah said, "God has endued me with good dowry, and now will my husband dwell with me, because I have borne him six sons." She called his name Zebulun, which means dwelling. And afterwards she had a daughter and called her name Dinah. Now they probably had other girls who are not named. Dinah is only named because she's going to come up in the story later on when we get to chapter 34. And so because she comes back into the story, we get her name, but they probably had other girls, but girls didn't count. Only boys counted in that culture. And so God remembered Rachel, and God hearkened unto her and opened her womb, and she conceived and bare a son and said, God has taken away my reproach. And she called his name Joseph and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. Joseph means adding. So now here in the first 14 years of Jacob's marriage, he has 11 sons and one named daughter born to him. Now you realize with the multiplicity of wives and also taking their mistresses, that there were no doubt times when there were dual pregnancies, that is, they were both pregnant at the same time, and thus we can understand how that your family could multiply very rapidly in 14 years, and you end up with at least 12 children. Again, possibly more, because there were probably more girls born. In sort of looking over the 12 sons. Now, Benjamin will be born when they get back into the land. These were all born while Jacob was still serving Laban the 14 years for the two girls. This is during that 14 years that he was serving in order to provide the dowry to marry the two girls. To Leah was born Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, Zebulun, and Dinah, the daughter. Reuben, meaning see a son. Simeon, hearing. Levi, joined. Judah, praise. Issachar, hired. Hired him for the mandrakes. Zebulun, dwelling. To Bilhah, Rachel's maid, was born Dan, the judge, and Naphtali, wrestling. To Zilpah, Leah's maid, was born Gad, a troop, and Asher, happy. And then to Rachel was born Joseph, which means adding. And then when they returned to the land, she bore a second son, but she died in childbirth. And as her son was being born, because it was such a terrible travail and birth, that she died in childbirth, she called his name Benoni, son of my sorrow. But Jacob was gracious and would not put that name on him, but changed his name to Benjamin, which is son of my right hand. She was then buried, and it was just between Jerusalem and Bethlehem that she had this tragedy, and there she was buried. And to the present day, as you go on the road between Jerusalem and Bethlehem, you pass the tomb of Rachel, and it is a place of spiritual pilgrimage for the Jews, and they go there to pray and to give honor to God in honor of Rachel, who is buried there. Now, one of the reasons why being childless was considered a curse is that every girl hoped that perhaps she would be the chosen one of God to bring the promised Messiah into the world. And not to have a child or not to have a son was disappointing, because they each one hoped that they would be the choice that God would make to bring a son into the world, as God had promised to Eve that the seed of the woman would bruise the serpent's head. So it was a thing that was hoped for by each young girl. Now, it is interesting how that Sarah was not able to have a son until she was 90 years old. She had been barren all that time. Rebecca, who was the mother of Jacob, lived with Isaac for 20 years before they had the twins. She was barren for the first 20 years of their marriage. Now here is Rachel, and for probably 10 years, she was barren, and now finally has a son. We will come to other places in the scriptures where God closed up the womb in order to accomplish eternal purposes. We will see this especially in the case of Samson, and we will see it in the case of Samuel, and especially Samuel, because God was wanting a man, and he had to get a woman before he could get a man, and he got Hannah's attention by closing her womb until she finally came into harmony with the purposes of God and said, God, if you will give me a son, I'll give him back to you all the days of his life. And Samuel was born. So here we find now the basis for the 12 tribes of Israel. It came to pass when Rachel had borne Joseph that Jacob sent to Laban, send me away. The 14 years that he had contracted for in order to have the two daughters is now fulfilled. And so Jacob is asking to be relieved that he might go home to his family. I want you to send me away, that I might go unto my own place, to my own country, and give me my wives and my children for whom I have served you, and let me go, for you know that my service which I have done for you. And Laban said unto him, I pray thee, if I have found favor in your eyes, tarry, for I have learned by experience that the Lord has blessed me for your sake. And we find this many places in Scripture where God has blessed a nation, or God has blessed a situation because of the righteous that are there. And Laban was smart enough to realize God's hand is on this fellow, and I have been blessed because of God's blessing upon him. And so he said, appoint me your wages and I will give it to you. Tell me what you want. I'll pay your wages. Stay on, you know, you shouldn't serve me for nothing. And so Jacob said, you know how I have served you and how your cattle were with me. For it was little that you had before I came, and now it is increased unto a multitude. Jacob also realized that under his husbandry, Laban had become rich. He now had large herds and flocks, which he had just a little when Jacob first started working. Now they're a multitude. And the Lord has blessed thee since my coming. And now when shall I provide for my own house also? In other words, I've provided for you. You're now rich. When am I going to provide? I don't have anything. All I have are all these kids and these wives. And, you know, I need to provide for my own. So he said, what shall I give you? And Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. If you will do this thing for me, I will again feed and keep your flock. I will pass through all your flock today, removing from them all of the speckled and spotted cattle, and all of the brown cattle among the sheep, and the spotted and the speckled among the goats, and of such shall be my hire. So shall my righteousness answer for me in the time to come, when it shall come for my hire before your face, everyone that is not speckled and spotted among the goats and the brown among the sheep, they shall be counted stolen with me. So my hire will be all of the speckled, spotted, and brown, the brown sheep, but the speckled and spotted cattle and goats. And if there are white sheep among my herd, then, you know, they can be counted as stolen from you. Or if there be the solid color cattle and the solid color goats and so forth. So Laban said, behold, I would it might be according to your word. Okay, I agree with it. But this Laban's a shrewd fellow. That day he went through, and he took all of the goats that were rain-streaked and spotted, and all of the she-goats that were speckled and spotted, and every one that had some white in it, and all of the brown among the sheep, and he gave them into the hands of his sons, and he sent them away 3 days' journey. In other words, he left Jacob with just all of the solid color cattle and all of the solid color goats and all of the brown, all of the white sheep. He left those with Jacob, but he took the rest so that they would be born to him, and left Jacob with just these others. He's a shrewd fellow. Won't give Jacob a chance to get any increase by taking away all of those that might reproduce the rain-streaked or spotted cattle. And so he set them away 3 days' journey between himself and Jacob, and Jacob fed the rest of Laban's flock. So he had all the solid colors and all of the white sheep. But Jacob is a clever fellow. And so he took rods of green poplar and the hazel and chestnut tree, and he pilled white streaks in them, pulled the bark off so that they were sort of striped. And he made the white appear which was in the rods. And he set the rods which he had pilled before the flocks in the gutters and in the watering troughs. And when the flocks came to drink, that they should conceive when they came to drink. When they were in heat, he would set them up there. And the flocks conceived before the rods and brought forth cattle, rain-streaked, speckled, and spotted. Now, whether or not there is any relationship between them looking as they are mating, looking at the rain-streaked poplar and trees and the straight trees, whether or not that had any effect upon the cattle and the goats and all being born rain-straight, we don't know. Of course, Jacob was much closer to husbandry. He maybe had discovered something. It doesn't seem to us that it would actually produce that type of cattle or sheep, but Jacob thought it did. It could be that it was just God's goodness and blessing on Jacob that it happened, but Jacob was cunning. He was devising. He was thinking, at least, that this is what was happening. It's a part of the cunning nature of Jacob. Of course, he's really in a contest with a fellow that is equally shrewd and a scoundrel also. These two guys are out to get each other, and they are a real match for each other. And so the flocks conceived before the rods, and they brought forth cattle, rain-streaked, speckled, and spotted. And Jacob separated the lambs and set the faces of the flocks towards the rain-streaked, and all of the brown of the flock of Laban, and he put his own flocks by themselves, and he put them not unto Laban's cattle. Came to pass, whensoever the stronger cattle did conceive, that Jacob laid the rods before the eyes of the cattle in the gutters, that they might conceive among the rods. But when the cattle were feeble, he put them not in. So the feebler were Laban's, and the stronger were Jacob's. And the man increased exceedingly and had many cattle and maidservants and manservants and camels and donkeys. I mean, he's becoming wealthy and he's increasing. Shrewd, cunning, Jacob, heel catcher, supplanter, scoundrel, or dirty, rotten, sneaky thief. God said, Jacob have I loved, Esau have I loved less. You say, well, I don't think that that is fair, that God would love Jacob and not love Esau as much. I don't have any problem with God not loving Esau very much. Esau wasn't a spiritual man. He wasn't interested in spiritual things. My great problem is God's love for this scoundrel, Jacob. That's the thing that amazes me. But also it's the thing that sort of thrills me, that I don't have to be perfect for God to love me. And God chose Jacob, and God loved Jacob. And God has chosen you, and God has loved you, not because you're perfect, not because you do everything right, not because you're flawless, but because he's God, and because God is love, and God loves each of us tonight, and what a thrilling thing. So Jacob heard the words of Laban's sons, who were saying, Jacob has taken away all that was our father's, and of that which was our father's has he gotten all of this glory. Look at how rich he is. Look at all of the servants, all of the herds and all that he has. And he got it from our dad. And Jacob beheld the countenance of Laban, and behold, it was not toward him as before. Laban realized, this guy is outsmarting me. This guy is getting the best of me, or the better of me, and he is not smiling anymore when he looks at Jacob. He's looking with squinted eyes, and he's not happy with him. So the Lord said unto Jacob, things are, and you know, it's interesting how that the Lord often makes us uncomfortable in a situation in order to move us on. Jacob is uncomfortable now in this situation. Things are getting tense. But God is using it to move Jacob on. You know, as he is increasing, becoming wealthy, and his herds are multiplying and all, he could become very settled right in that area. He could have thought, you know, why move? This is great territory. And he could have become settled there, but God now makes things uncomfortable in order to move him on. Sometimes God puts us in uncomfortable situations, and his purpose is to get our attention, to cause us to start looking to him, to cause us to be open to what he might be wanting to do. You go to work one day and you're called into the boss's office and he hands you the pink slip. We don't need you any longer. And we get desperate. We begin to cry out and say, oh God, you know, what's going on here? God, what am I going to do? And God says, well, nice to hear from you. Missed you lately. But God wanted to get your attention because, you see, he had something better for you, but you weren't looking for it. You'd become very settled in the position you were in. And you weren't open to the leading of God. And so he gets your attention. And then he says, okay, time to move on. So he's got Jacob's attention with a squinty-eyed father-in-law and the brothers all upset. So the Lord spoke to Jacob. And he said, return to the land of your fathers and to your family, and I will be with you. This is an important promise. Return and I will be with you. Now, God promised him that the night that he was using the rock for the pillow, the next morning when God spoke to him, he told him that he would bring him back into the land in peace. It's important that he has this promise of God because for a while things are going to look very dark and grim. And we'll get that next week in our study of chapters 32 and 33. We're going to look at some extremely dark hours in Jacob's life. As he receives news, as he is coming back into the land, he receives news, your brother Esau is coming to meet you, and he has 400 men with him. And Jacob becomes terrified because the last time he saw his brother was vowing to kill him. So God is saying, return, and I will be with you. And so Jacob sent, and he called Rachel and Leah to the field unto his flock. He sent for them to come out into the field to talk with him. The tents might be bugs, so he brings them out into the field. No, the other servants might hear, and he just wants it to be confidential. So he said unto them, I see your father's countenance, his face. It's not toward me as before. But the God of my father has been with me, and you know that with all of my power I have served your father, and your father has deceived me. He has changed my wages 10 times, but God would not allow him to hurt me. And if he said thus, the speckled shall be your wages, then all of the cattle bore speckled. If he said, the rein straight shall be your hire, then bear all of the cattle the rein straight. And thus God has taken away the cattle of your father and given them to me. And it came to pass at the time that the cattle conceived that I lifted up my eyes and I saw in a dream, and behold, the rams which leaped upon the cattle were rein straight, speckled, and grizzled. And the angel of God spoke unto me in a dream, saying, Jacob. And I said, here I am. And he said, lift up now your eyes and see all of the rams which leap upon the cattle. They are rein straight, speckled, and grizzled, for I have seen all that Laban has done to you. I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed the pillar and where you vowed a vow unto me. Now rise, get thee out of this land and return unto the land of your family. Now, when Jacob was at Bethel, where he met God, and God promised to be with him and to bring him back into the land in peace, Jacob said, Lord, if you do this, if you give me a safe journey, and if you prosper me, and if you bring me back safe again, then you will be my God, and I will give you a tenth of everything that I have. He made that vow to God. God is now reminding him of that vow. It's some 20 years later, but now he is returning a wealthy man. He'll talk about this when he gets to the stream Jabbok and he crosses it. He'll remember the last time he crossed the ford that all he had was a cane. When I came across this stream before, all I had was a cane, and now I have so much, I have to divide it into two companies in order to travel with greater ease. So Rachel and Leah answered and said unto him, Is there yet any portion or inheritance for us in our father's house? I mean, we don't have anything here. Are we not counted of him as strangers? For he has sold us and has quite devoured also our money. Now it was the duty of the father to hold in trust the dowry that he received for his daughters, in case they should ever go back home, that they would have money to keep them so that they wouldn't have to be on welfare. But Laban had devoured or spent the money that really was the girls, that he was to keep in trust for them, but he had spent it, and the girls resented that. And they said, we don't have anything here. He looks upon us as strangers, and he's devoured our money. For all of the riches which God has taken from our father, that is actually ours and our children. And now then, whatever God has said unto you, do. Great to have wives that are in harmony with the purposes of God, and they will say, whatever God tells you, honey, go ahead and do it. Thank God for such a wife. She's just great. Then Jacob rose up, and he set his sons and his wives upon camels. Now, they had these sort of little, carriage kind of things that they would set on the camels. It wasn't that bad of a ride. It was a little sort of a coach thing that they would set up on the camels. And you've probably seen it in pictures and all. It's sort of like a chariot in a sense. And they would sit up in these cushions and so forth. Of course, camels are not, they're bumpy, but at least you're cushioned and you're sort of enclosed in these little carriage type things that they would set on the camels. And so he set his sons and his wives upon the camels, and he carried away all of his cattle and all of his goods which he had gotten, the cattle of his getting which he had gotten in Paddan Aram, to go to Isaac, his father, in the land of Canaan. Now, unfortunately, his mother, Rebekah, had died in this 20-year interim period, and he never saw his mother again. But his father, Isaac, was still living as he is returning back. So Laban went to shear his sheep, and Rachel had stolen the images that were her father's. These little images, they believe, were in the form of men. They were called teraphim, and they used them for divination. They were considered idols and idolatry by God. And Laban had them, and Rachel is ripping them off. And Jacob stole away unaware to Laban, the Syrian. Interesting, Laban, the Syrian. Actually Abraham was a Syrian as far as background. And he stole away from Laban, the Syrian, in that he did not tell him that he fled. So he fled with all that he had, and he rose up and passed over the river, and he set his face toward Mount Gilead. And it was told Laban on the third day that Jacob was fled. And so he took his brethren with him, and he pursued after him for 7 days' journey, and they overtook him in the Mount Gilead. So they were 3 days away, shearing their sheep. When Jacob left, someone ran on down the three-day journey to Laban, and they said, Jacob has taken off with the family and all of his goods. And so it took him probably the 3 days to get back to where Jacob had left from, and then the next 7 days he was pursuing after Jacob. So the total length of time from the time that Jacob left until Laban caught up with him was probably somewhere around 12 or 13 days. And Jacob, of course, is doing his best to make good time, because he realizes that when Laban finds out, that it is very possible that Laban will pursue after him. So he took his brothers with him, and he pursued after him for 7 days' journey, and he overtook him in the Mount Gilead. Now, to make it from there to Mount Gilead means that they were really moving in those 12 days. It was double time, and probably from early dawn till the last hours of dusk in the evening, they were hurrying on to get back to the land. And so God came to Laban, the Syrian, in a dream by night. And he said unto him, "Be careful that you do not speak to Jacob either good or bad." Then Laban overtook Jacob. And now Jacob had pitched his tent in the mount, and Laban with his brethren pitched in the mount of Gilead. And Laban said to Jacob, now he's under strict orders by God, you know, don't say good or bad. And so Laban said to Jacob, "What have you done? You have stolen away unaware to me. You've carried away my daughters as captives, taken with a sword. Why have you fled away secretly and stolen away from me? And you did not tell me, that I might have sent you away with parties and with songs and tabrets and with a harp." Oh, yeah, of course. But you see, he can't say bad. He can't say what he really wants to say. And so he acts like he's been offended and hurt. You know, why would you go off with my daughters? You didn't even give me a chance to have a big party and a going away party and send you off, you know, with blessings and so forth. He would have surely done that. "And you've not allowed me to kiss my sons and my daughters." And they didn't have a word for grandsons, as we have mentioned before, or granddaughters. And I can understand this, not being able to kiss your grandkids goodbye. I mean, that would be mean and tough. And so that's what he's complaining about. "I didn't even have a chance to kiss my grandkids goodbye, you know, and you've snuck off like this." Don't you realize, and now he's really revealing his heart, don't you realize that it is in the power of my hand to really do you hurt? But the God of your father spoke to me last night, saying, "Take heed that you speak not to Jacob either good or bad." Don't you realize, man, I could really take care of you now, but your God stopped me. So now, though you would need be gone, understand that, because you have longed after your father's house, yet why have you stolen my gods? I always find that extremely humorous. That a man would have gods that can be stolen. That to me is just, why have you stolen my gods? What kind of a god can, you know, do you have that can be stolen? But he's talking about these little idols. Jacob answered and said to Laban, "It's because I was afraid. For I said, peradventure, you would take by force your daughters from me." And he was probably right. And it was probably a legitimate fear. "With whomsoever you find your gods, let him not live." Now he didn't know that Rachel had ripped off her father's idols. And so he said, "Our brothers discern what is yours and what is mine, and take to you that which is yours." So Jacob did not know that Rachel had stolen them. So Laban went into Jacob's tent, into Leah's tent, into the two maidservants' tents, and he found them not. Then went he out of Leah's tent and entered into Rachel's tent. Now Rachel had taken the images and put them in the camel's furniture, the trappings and all that they put on the camels, and she was sitting on them. And Laban searched all the tent, but did not find them. And she said to her father, "Let it not displease my lord that I cannot rise up before thee, for the custom of women is upon me." And he searched, but he found not the images. He probably figured that she wouldn't be sitting on gods. And she said, "I'm after the manner of women," or "I'm going through the monthly menstrual cycle," and a woman was considered unclean at that time, and whoever would touch her would, and the things that she's touched were considered unclean. So, of course, she's a chip off the old man. I mean, she's a deceiver too. And so then Jacob acts in righteous indignation. He's ticked off. And he is angry. And he chides with Laban. And Jacob answered and said to Laban, "What is my trespass? What is my sin that you should so hotly pursue after me? Whereas you have searched all of the luggage, what have you found of all the of your household stuff? Set it on here before the brethren and let them be judged between us both. These 20 years I've been with you, the ewes and the she-goats have not cast their young." In other words, they all bore. I was there to help them through the process of giving birth, the birthing of the lambs and so forth. Of the flock, the rams of the flock, I haven't eaten them. That which was torn of the beast, I did not bring to you. I bore the loss of it. Of my hand did you require it. And whether it was stolen by day or stolen by night. And thus I was with you in the daytime. I was consumed with the heat and the drought. I was thirsty. By night, I couldn't sleep because I was watching the animals. And thus I have been 20 years in your house. And I served you for 14 years for your two daughters, 6 years for your cattle, and you have changed my wages 10 times. You're a rotten, sneaky thief. Sort of hurts when a rotten, sneaky thief is telling you that. And except the God of my father, the God of Abraham, and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely you would have sent me away empty. But God has seen mine affliction and the labor of my hands, and he rebuked you last night. So Laban answered and said unto Jacob, "These daughters are my daughters, and these children are my children, and these cattle are my cattle, and all that you have and can see is mine. And what can I do except unto, what can I do this day unto these my daughters and unto their children which they have borne? Now therefore, come, let's make a covenant, and you and I, and let it be as a witness between you and me." And Jacob took a stone, and he set it up for a pillar. And Jacob said to his brethren, "Gather stones," and they took the stones, and they made a heap of stones, and they did eat there upon the stones. And Laban called it Jegar Shedhad Dutha. But Jacob called it Gilead. I like Jacob's name better, Gilead. And in reality, it is a word that just means the heap of witness. That's the stones. These stones are a witness of this covenant that we're making. And Laban said, "This heap is a witness between you and me this day." Therefore was the name of it called Gilead. And Mizpah, for he said, "The Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another." Now, that is a beautiful thing, isn't it? To depart saying Mizpah. The Lord watch between you and me while we are absent one from another. And many people have picked up that word, and when they say goodbye to their friends, they say mispah. And it really sounds very beautiful. The Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another. But in the context, it is, I know that you're a dirty, rotten, sneaky thief. And I'm not going to be able to watch you. And I don't want you mistreating my daughters or my grandkids. And so may the Lord watch between you and me while we're absent, because I can't keep my eye on you. May God keep his eye on you and watch between you and me while we're absent one from another. You may not want to use that as a departing little word. If you shall afflict my daughters, you see, God watch you, because if you afflict my daughters, or if you shall take other wives beside my daughters, no man is with us to see, but God be a witness between me and you. God watch you, man. And so Laban said to Jacob, behold this heap, and behold this pillar that I have cast between me and you. This heap, may it be a witness, and this pillar be a witness, that I will not pass over this heap to thee, and you shall not pass over this heap from this pillar unto me for harm. Let this be the dividing line. I won't come back over it, and I don't want you to come back, come beyond it. Let it be the place of division, that I won't come back to do you harm, and I don't want you coming this way to do me harm. And may the God of Abraham, the God of Nahor, who was Laban's grandfather, and who was the brother of the father of Abraham, the God of their father, judge between us. And Jacob swore by the fear of his father Isaac. Then Jacob offered a sacrifice upon the mount, and he called his brethren to eat the bread, and they did eat bread. They tarried all night in the mount, and early in the morning Laban rose up, kissed his grandkids and his daughters, and he blessed them, and Laban departed and returned to his place. Jacob continues on his way, but trouble is ahead, big trouble. And so we have some exciting adventures of Jacob in the next couple of chapters, as we see God continuing to work, and the tremendous, the great transformation where Jacob, this cunning scoundrel, is changed, transformed, and he becomes a man who is governed by God. But we see the processes that God had to take in order to bring him to submission. It's awfully hard to reach some people who are so self-sufficient, who are always capable of mastering every situation. It's often hard to bring them to the place of recognizing their need for God and surrendering unto God, because they are so accustomed to living by their own devices, schemes, and wits. Such a man was Jacob, but God brought him to his knees. And what a glorious day in the life of any man when God brings him to his knees in surrender to God. And so we'll see the wonderful transformation of this scoundrel as God changes his name from heel catcher to governed by God, his new name, governed by God. Father, we thank you for the work of your Holy Spirit in our lives, and that you have brought us to that place of submission where we have surrendered our lives to you that we might be governed by your Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask you to rule over our lives. Take control. Make us, Lord, the people you would have us to be. Lord, we thank you that you loved Jacob even when he was a rascal. And we thank you, Lord, that you finally brought him to the place of surrender, where you could then do for him all that you were desiring to do, as you used him to father the nation of Israel. Lord, work in us, work through us, your perfect work. May we be surrendered and yielded. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we stand? The pastors are down here in the front this evening to pray for your needs. Maybe you've come to the place where you realize you need to surrender your life to God. Maybe God has pulled you up abruptly and has things are not going so well, and you realize time has come for a change and you need to seek the Lord and his guidance. They're here to pray for you. God wants to work in your life. God wants to speak to you tonight. God wants to direct you in his path. And so we encourage you, after we're dismissed, come on forward. They're here to pray for your needs and to minister to you by the Holy Spirit. May the Lord be with you, and may you have a wonderful week as you open your heart to the things of God and as we walk in the Spirit, seeking the will of God for our lives. Rule over my soul. Rule over my soul. Sweet Spirit, rule over my soul. My rest is complete as I sit at your feet. Sweet Spirit, rule over my soul. Rule over my soul. Rule over my soul. Sweet Spirit, rule over my soul. My rest is complete as I sit at your feet. Sweet Spirit, rule over my soul. God bless you.
And now, on behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact the Word for Today at the Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.